Welcome back to the Mission by Michiana. So I wanted to make a new video about Robert's Rules of Order. Robert's Rules is something that a lot of tribal governments use in operating their boards, in their meetings that their different departments may have, in any committees. So you use it for all different kinds of meetings. Even in the larger community, out in club meetings or rotary, things like that. And it's something that I didn't know about until I became a youth leader on my tribe's council. It's something that I wish they had taught in school. It's one of those skills that you'll use in different arenas for the rest of your life, but they don't teach it for some reason. Instead, we learn how to dissect a frog or, I don't know, George Washington's birthday, which, let's be honest, who cares? Anyways, I figured what I'd do is break down this Robert's Rules of Order in plain English. I have the second edition, and I think it's something that young people should know, and I'm gonna do my best to walk through it with you. And I'm thinking this will be a series. We'll see how long it takes. It's not a very big book, to be honest. A lot of it is like examples of the situation that they're speaking of at the moment. Anyways, I'll walk through it the best that I can. Hopefully you get something out of it. Hopefully you learn a little bit and can pass it on. So the book starts with how it all began. And the first sentence is pretty funny considering. Anyways, you'll see. It's pretty funny. Parliamentary procedure came to America with our ancestors. Did it? Our ancestors? Some of our ancestors were already here. The term refers to the rules that have evolved over time to facilitate the democratic transaction of decision-making in an organized group. So basically, Robert's Rules is an easy way to conduct business so that people aren't speaking over one another, so that the topic at hand remains the topic at hand. You know, sometimes you get into meetings and you have people that wander onto all these different subjects or make something bigger than it needs to be. Robert's Rules was created so that when a group of people dedicated to a cause come together, they can speak on the issues that need to be discussed in a civilized and productive manner. American parliamentary procedure is based on the procedural rules used in English Parliament. So basically, the people that came over from England and began to build the United States as we know it today, back when there was the Continental Congress, before there was even the United States Congress, they were looking for a way to conduct their governmental business. And they fell back on what they knew from their past in England, and that was parliamentary procedure. Now, America obviously didn't have a parliament because that's what those same people were trying to get away from, that way of governing. But they took the pieces that were still relevant to the way that they conducted business and applied those to the Continental Congress. The first version of this was created by Thomas Jefferson in 1801, which was called the Manual of Parliamentary Practice. This gave a baseline for everyone in Congress to work off of, but it was still a really dense text that not everybody had the time to get through, not everybody understood, and there are still a few things left up in the air that weren't even discussed in what he presented. So, in 1876, Henry Martin Robert created a more concise handbook to be used in non-legislative organizations. This was accessible to everyone, and that became known as Robert's Rules of Order, which became widespread throughout the United States all the way from 1876 until today. It is used from coast to coast, and if you learn the basics, you can join in to any organization and be a productive member of that organization. Even college clubs and high school clubs use the basics of Robert's Rules of Order to conduct their business and to accomplish their goals. So the first part of this book goes through the basic rules of Robert's Rules of Order. So I'll just walk you through the 10 basic rules. The first is, the rights of the organization supersede the rights of the individual. This basically means that if, let's say you're having a family meeting and you're trying to decide what you all want to eat for dinner, and your dad proposes, let's go out to eat at a restaurant. That becomes the discussion item on the table. That's what the group is focusing on. And the family begins to discuss different restaurants that maybe they want to eat at. Meanwhile, your little brother starts to have a temper tantrum and says things like,
"We never eat what I want."
And he's all about himself. In that scenario, your father or your mother, depending on which one is the chairperson, has the right to say, right now we're discussing whether we'd like to go out to a restaurant. That's what we need to decide. Then we can decide the food we want. We're not going to spend time fighting over your individual feelings when we as a group are trying to come to a decision on this piece of the discussion. The family has a right to conduct business in an orderly manner. That call for order supersedes his individual right to have a temper tantrum. Rule number two is that all members are equal and their rights are equal. And those rights include the right to attend meeting, to make motions and speak in a debate, to nominate, to vote, and to hold office. So your little brother has the right to voice what he wants to eat for dinner, but he has to wait until he is called on by the chair, your mother. Number three, a quorum must be present to conduct business. Now, a quorum means a majority of the members are present, and this is usually stated in the bylaws. And the purpose of ensuring that there's a quorum present is that no small faction of the group can conduct business on behalf of the whole. So like two people out of your board of 10 can't make a decision that represents the entire organization and maybe can have a detrimental effect without getting approval by everyone. Number four is that majority rules. And this is just a basic rule that says if the majority of the members vote on an action, then that action must go forth. So if your whole family votes to go to the Italian restaurant that your father suggested, then your little brother who is throwing the temper tantrum has to get in the car and go with everybody to the Italian restaurant. If he somehow convinces you, your mom, and your sister to go along with his fast food cheeseburger idea, then your dad has to go with the group and get cheeseburgers. And number five, silence is consent. That's right. If you don't vote, it's counted as an affirmative. You have to voice either a yes or a no when voting on an issue. Those who don't vote are in essence agreeing to go along with the majority. So this is important because say there's a board of seven people. Following the rules of quorum, you would only need five people to be present in order to hold a meeting. Now, of those five people, if two of them voted in favor of an issue, two people abstained from voting due to conflict of interest, and one person voted against it, that would mean that majority is voting for the issue. So in essence, out of the entire board, because only five were present, two abstained, two voted in the affirmative, they then become the majority and the motion passes. So two people made a decision for the entire organization. And those are the first five of the basic rules of Robert's Rules of Order. Like I said, I'm gonna be making a series out of this one, so there'll definitely be more to come back and check out. I'll be breaking down the other five rules in my next video, and then moving forward through the rest of the book. And I recommend picking up this book. It gives a really basic breakdown of these rules, makes them easy to understand and easy to apply. And if you know how to use Robert's rules, then you know how to function in any organization and you can make a difference in your community. Also, I'm wearing my Every Native Vote Counts shirt today. Be sure to check out nativevote.org. It is election season. Native American people, Alaska Native people, we can make a difference in the elections and the landscape of this country, how we're treated, what our say is in legislation, but we have to get out and make sure that we vote for people who will listen to us, who will take us into consideration, and include us in conversations that we've been left out of for far too long now. So I encourage you to get out there and vote and let your voice be heard. Thank you for checking out my video. I'll be posting another one on Robert's Rules soon. Be sure to check out the other videos I have posted. Subscribe if you're not already subscribed to my channel, and I'll talk to you guys again soon. Gunchish!